Good afternoon, everybody. Sorry, I'm a couple minutes late. Welcome. We don't have any new members here, do we? I don't think so. So welcome to the April 11th WAMPO Transit Policy Body Meeting. We will start the meeting off with our regular business. I hope you all got a copy of stuff. Item A is to approve the April 11th, today's meeting agenda. Is there any corrections or comments? If not, I'd entertain a motion to approve.
We make a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Thank you, Claire.
Second.
Thanks, Dan. Motion to approve the agenda and seconded. Any other comments? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Next is item B is the approval of the of our last month's meeting of the minutes, March 14th minutes. Any additions or corrections or comments? Being none, entertain a motion to approve the minutes.
We make a motion to approve the March 14th meeting minutes.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Been a motion and a second to approve the minutes. Any comments? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Any opposition? Being none, the motion carries. Director's reports.
Just a couple of items, Mr. Chair. You received in your packet a copy of the regional transportation profile. There's a lot of good information in there. Mainly it's kind of a going back on the Move 2040 activities provided, the basis for the profile. The information is, could be useful for you and public and stakeholders and decision makers in your discussions with interested citizens. Also, we have a call for projects for the 5310 program. That's the enhanced mobility for seniors and individuals with disabilities. We've had some work on that with Wichita Transit, and we'll be calling for projects to utilize some of that money. We're also working on a mobile app for the bike count, and we're working on a second grant application to help fund the interactive app for bike ped volunteers. And that should be sometime this spring. Be happy to entertain any questions if you have any.
Any questions? Comments? Okay. Thank you, Phil. Moving on, we now go into our public comment section. Does anybody from the public like to address the policy body? If so, move to the podium. Looks like none. Sure. Okay. Next item is planning considerations. We get into our speaker series now. Trends, Kathy.
Well, as part of our speaker series and our look at trends, we've invited Jason Gregory, the Executive Vice President for the Wichita Downtown Development Corporation, to come and speak to us today. Jason is responsible for launching and guiding various initiatives leading the implementation of Project Downtown, Wichita Downtown Master Plan, and the Wichita Downtown Development Corporation Strategic Business Plan. He also provides key leadership for the Downtown Design Resource Center, whose mission is to connect and engage individuals in the development of Wichita's downtown. Jason is a Wichita area native, Cheney, I believe it is. All right, good Cheney, represented today. He has a diverse background in business, landscape architecture, urban design, project management, and construction. He received a bachelor's degree in business administration from Friends University and a master's degree in landscape architecture from Kansas State University. So he's got the nicest yard in Cheney. Yeah. Jason is an elected school board member for USD 268 in Cheney and is involved in his local church. He also volunteers his time coaching numerous youth sports. He is a member of the International Downtown Association and is a member of the Wichita Parks Foundation Board of Directors. Jason is married to his wife, Angie, and they have three sons. Here is Jason.
Okay. Welcome, Jason. How's the injury?
So it's good. And she mentioned that youth sports. I used to tell people I had a better story, but this was actually coaching youth sports that I got this injury. So where's the, oh, there it is. There we go. Well, first off, thank you for having me. You know, typically a lot of you I know well, others I'm meeting for the first time today, but it's a pleasure to be here in front of this body. Obviously, you guys represent the Sedgwick County and Butler County communities that represent the greater Wichita area. And so having the opportunity to come talk about downtown, you're used to me talking about downtown. But today I think I want to take a different approach. I'm going to put on a different hat because other people know me as Mr. Cheney. And instead of Mr. Downtown, and aside from my family, I'm probably most proud of my community of Cheney, Kansas. I grew up on a farm, like she said, south of Cheney. I'm still a farm kid at heart, and so the irony that I lead the economic development effort for the urban center for our region is ironic, especially for my father who farms and doesn't have a clue what I do. But today, what I'd like to talk to this group about, and a question I get asked a lot, particularly as a small community in Sedgwick County, what is downtown? Why should I care about downtown Wichita? Why are we investing money in downtown Wichita? And what's the relevance that it has to Mays, Andover, Derby, Cheney, Colwich? And so with that, I'd like to talk a little bit about, I'll give some background to our organization, what we do. Some of you are familiar with this, but those of you that aren't. The Downtown Development Corporation, so we're a 501c3 nonprofit. We're not the city. We are a private company. We are funded, though, through a property tax mill levy. So the county assesses the properties in the downtown district, and we have a agreement with the city to provide the services that we do. So the lion's share of the stakeholders that pay into that mill levy, though, are represented on our board of directors. So in a sense, they are our stakeholders. We're working on their behalf every day when we get up to try to spur and stimulate investment in downtown Wichita. Also wanted to talk a little bit about Project Downtown, the impetus for a lot of the revitalization that we have seen since basically 2011. Many of you in your communities and your jurisdictions obviously have community plans. One of the things I think the city of Wichita did well and did right in partnership with our organization when they did Project Downtown is they built the plan on market economics. So in addition to, and in my background, you know, I've been a part of many community planning efforts, and a lot of folks fail because it's just a visioning exercise and then it gets put on the shelf and everybody forgets about what they talked about. But as the stakeholders or the private sector implementers of the plan, we constantly make sure that it's relevant. And when they started that plan, they looked at what our downtown markets could actually do. So what's the market potential for downtown Wichita? And then they built the vision on top of that. And I really think that's in large part the success that we've seen. Globally, we've seen about $450 million in investment in the downtown Smith District since 2011. And this map here is a representation. Obviously, no one area. The size and scope of those projects are continually to increase. But the public sector, you know, one of the main things with Project Downtown, it talked about the public sector being a catalyst for private sector development. And really, that has really proven itself out. The city of Wichita has stepped up in many ways to be a catalyst. In fact, the plan itself was built around catalyst sites, so city-owned properties that could be catalysts for future development. But that the city would not build it and hope they came, but build it in conjunction with the private sector to stimulate that investment. The other thing about downtown Wichita that's really a challenge is that it's a large geographic area. If you look, it's about a mile square. Urban renewal in the 60s and 70s tore down every other building. So we've got a surface parking lot next to what was once a building in almost the entire district. So walkability, improving the connectivity are really key things that we're talking about. And one of our focus since day one has been to focus on Douglas Avenue. And really, that's our main street. Many communities have a main street or that epicenter. Douglas is our postcard avenue, or Michigan Avenue. And so we've put a heightened concentration on really making sure that investment happens there. And you can see we've seen over $280 million in investment. And again, private sector stepping up in a lot of cases to stimulate, spur that private sector development. So let's back out and shift from that overview of the WDC in downtown. Let's talk about from a regional context. You know, so the Greater Wichita Partnership, going on 2 years now, was created with a new strategy. And really, they looked at really six key priorities listed here, one of those being downtown vitality. And really, when you peel back all the layers, downtown has a sliver of influence with every single one of these priorities. And I want to get into kind of the reasons why. So when you think about Wichita, this region as a whole, we're competing not necessarily even nationally, but globally. And when you start talking about metropolitan areas, you're really talking about regions. So obviously, but when you talk about South Central Kansas, the greater nation global doesn't know where that is. When we talk to site selectors, we're lucky if we can get them to know where Wichita's at in the state of Kansas. So when we talk about Wichita, we're really talking about that 10 county region and downtown Wichita being that epicenter of urban activity. So much with Project Downtown is our plan for development, for growth, for the urban center. We also have that same plan in Bragg for the regional. And again, I talked about Catalyst. Bragg really focuses on those things that we're already doing well, what the industry sectors are that we can continue to build upon. And I think later, potentially the partnership will come and talk specifically about that. I won't dive into those specifics today, just due to time. So economic development, I talked about a shift with the partnership. You know, there was what I want to say the old way, the 20th century model was throw cash at companies and hope that you can woo them here. You know, the new model is really, and Oklahoma City is a great example of this. You know, American Airlines, many of you know that story. They lost to Indianapolis, and they came back and asked, you know, what was wrong with the $200 million that we were going to give to you? And they basically said, you guys haven't invested in yourself. And so they ended up going to Indianapolis. And so that was a lesson for Oklahoma City to say, we have to invest in ourselves. From an infrastructure, from a quality of life standpoint, if we're going to be an attractor for these companies. So you can see here, you know, the 21st century model really is a public-private partnership. It's very strategic, laser recruitment. So I talked about those industry clusters. We're not just shotgun approaching it. We're really going after targeted companies, targeted industries, high value, highly trained talent. So not just any job will do. We want the highly skilled, highly educated. The infrastructure used to be, you know, roads or other infrastructure. Now it's educational attainment. So companies that are looking at our region are looking at our workforce and how well equipped are those folks. And then it's driven by an overall vision. And I think now we collectively, as a region, have both that vision and look forward. At the end of the day, though, it's all about talent. And everybody hears that. You've heard that buzzword, attracting and retaining talent. So what do I mean by that? So it's this group called the millennials, right? They have different wants and needs. We know this nationally. We know trend-wise. We're seeing a shift, obviously, here locally. I'll talk a little bit about that. But not only the millennials, but Gen Z. So my kids, that's the next generation of labor. And so these companies are looking at not next year, but 15. What's the 20-year pipeline for the workforce that they're going to need? And what we know is that group of individuals want to be in urban centers. They want to be within 3 miles of an urban center. That's what their preferences are. It's a complete shift in the boomer generation that has driven our economy since World War II. And that's really what's driving the renaissance that we're seeing. And it's things like this that this group is really interested in. They want quality of life. So there's a reason that the pop-up urban park project that we did down here on Douglas Avenue, we filled in a former hole in the ground, and it's activated daily with food trucks. There's a reason that the millennials love that. And there's also a reason that that would never work out on, you know, one of our big box thoroughfares if we stuck that out there on a parking lot and said, hey, come. It doesn't have the intimacy. It doesn't have the human scale. It doesn't have the walkable feel that does in the urban setting. And so we know from places like Austin, from places like Oklahoma City, 30 years ago, Austin was the same size as Wichita. They made strategic decisions then to become very walkable urban. They focused on density. In fact, Austin at the time established a growth boundary. They didn't let any more growth happen on the periphery. All the development had to happen internally. And you can see what's happened now. I mean, they're 2 to 3 times the size of Wichita, and they've tremendous growth in that community since making those decisions again to invest in themselves. The other thing we're seeing is the national trend of companies choosing to relocate to downtown, and there's many reasons, and it's not just large companies. Small companies are making this decision too, particularly startups. Again, I talked about attracting and retaining the talent, but a lot of people that we talk to that move to downtown, it's because that's part of their culture. They want to be seen by either A, their peers, their clients, or their employees as somebody who's embracing that urban culture. It increases opportunity for collaboration. So an example I give, so if I get in my car and I drive to Sonic for lunch, you know, it's just me, myself, and my car interacting. But if I walk down to the pop-up park, I see no fewer than probably 20 people I know. They're serendipitous conversations, and it's that conversation that these companies are all excited and interested in, and they want to be able to generate that because they know that that pays dividends to them. And then the other story that we're hearing is a lot of them just, they want to be part of the story. So they want to be part of the city's revitalization effort. They want that to be part of their marketing and be able to say, we were a contributor because we helped in the development of the urban core. And how do we know that? Well, that's because that's what Cargill told us. And Cargill's a global company. They have, obviously, sites in many countries, many cities across the nation. And they chose to stay in Wichita. But they chose to stay in downtown, particularly Old Town, because of those things. It was all, to them, it was, and this is, I'll paraphrase a quote, it was dynamic, aesthetic, and collaborative work environment. That was, they felt that was the key for them to attracting the talented workforce they're going to need for the next 20 years. And so they'll soon be demolishing the former Wichita Eagle building and building this state-of-the-art headquarter facility in downtown Wichita. But it was because they wanted to be able to take their clients at lunch to a whole host of food offerings across the street and be able to entertain their employees and customers in that regard. So some other national trends I think are important for us to watch, and that's what we try to do, is bring these to local light because it's happening here as well. In 1950, what spurred a lot of our suburban development as we know it was, again, the populations with children. 50% of all households in 1950 had kids in them. Only 25% of all households today have children. And for the next 20 years, it's going to be only about 14%. So those baby boomers that I talked about that have been driving this, the kids are gone now. And we already know that they're downsizing. A lot of them are approaching retirement or retiring. They don't want to take care of the yard anymore, or they're getting too old to do those types of tasks. And so they're downsizing. They want to move downtown where they're close to the coffee shop, where they can walk to the concert, where they can close their condo and go to the vacation and not have to worry about the yard. The other group that's driving it are the millennials. Most of them aren't getting married till well after, you know, than folks did 20, 30 years ago. Now they're waiting till later in life to A, get married, and B, have children. And if they're having children, they're having fewer. The family sizes are much smaller now. In a lot of cases, it's single parent households. They prefer to be in an urban environment. Another huge shift, other than the demographics, is income property market. So you can see in from 92 to 2000, walkable urban, you know, investment properties. So this would be anything other than your place of residence. So whether that's commercial or residential income property, suburban made up the lion's share of the market. Today, it's almost 50-50, and urban continues to outpace by far what's being built and from a valuation standpoint. So my point, though, today, and this is one thing that I always bring up, is that it's not about downtown versus the suburbs. It can never be that conversation. We have to have a healthy suburbs. We have to have a healthy suburban market. Our communities are dependent, our bedroom communities like Cheney, are dependent on Wichita for what? They're dependent on it for jobs. You know, so many people that live and choose Cheney as a community are dependent on Wichita for jobs. But at the end of the day, the only thing that we're going to be able to do, or the only way that we're going to be able to increase jobs is by having a vibrant urban core. Site selectors come here, and for years they saw vacant buildings in our downtown. And no offense, but that's the first impression. That's the impression they have when they leave here. They may not even make it to your community, or they may not even make it to that suburban market where they're looking to place a new factory. If that downtown market, the lights are out and they don't feel like it's thriving, they're not going to look any farther. And so we have to have that urban center, whether you live or work there, it's still important because it's how we grow jobs. I think one last thing that I think is really important to note, particularly from your vantage point as, in a lot of cases, elected officials or administrators who are stewards of tax dollars. I know as a school board member, we're constantly talking about what's the best return on our investment, because every decision you make is with limited resources, right? So whether that's investing in infrastructure, nationally, urban centers produce 12 times more tax revenue than their suburban counterparts. And a lot of that obviously is because of the density. So we've built a lot of our communities the past 50 years with the same amount of infrastructure investment. In fact, more so in a lot of cases, particularly suburban cul-de-sac type developments that don't have the same return on investment as higher density areas. Walkable neighborhoods, so walkable, I'm gonna say the old neighborhoods, you know, your College Hill, your Riverside, traditionally, and this is again national numbers, walkable neighborhoods produce 6 times more tax revenue than their suburban counterparts. And a lot of that, in lion's share, that is based on a density. We just don't have the density to offset those costs. I know we've done the study here locally, downtown Wichita, compared to the rest of the metropolitan area, is about 5 times more valuable from a valuation standpoint than the rest of the metropolitan area. So when you're making a return on investment, you're talking about the life cycle costs, right, of that infrastructure. So it's not only the cost to build it, because there's that, but whether it's a suburban neighborhood where we're taxing special assessments, or you're talking about a parking garage in downtown, that's public dollars, right, supporting that infrastructure. So we have to be mindful of what's the life cycle cost of that and what's the return on that investment. And what we found, and I think, you know, the comprehensive planning effort that was just done for Sedgwick County, you know, our infrastructure costs are enormous, and we've got a huge, huge hill to climb in the next 20 years, 20, 30 years with our infrastructure. So building more roads every time we kick the can down the road, it just means that at some point that tax base has to support that. And so one of the things, you know, that plan talked about, not only downtown, but how do we re-densify some of our neighborhoods? Chris Leinberger was here earlier this year, and he really talked about one of the strategies that they're looking at, particularly in major metros like Dallas and Fort Worth, where suburbanization is much, much more rampant than here, is how are they converting those suburban developments into walkable urban? And they're seeing the return on that investment, again, densifying areas to have a better return on that tax dollar. I guess just in closing, and then I definitely want to stand for any questions, but as a Cheney native and resident, you know, we're all in this together. Downtown Wichita has obviously importance for the Wichita metropolitan area, but it's still very impactful and very important for the region. At the end of the day, you know, it's all about job creation. How do we attract and retain the next generation of people? How many of you have kids that have either moved away or said that they're not going to stay here? We have to build a place that they say they're willing to stay. And, you know, for a lot of millennials, it's a quality of life decision. Many of those either graduate with a degree and they go choose the city before they have the job. We know this. People are moving in droves to Austin, Texas because it's cool, or they're moving to Portland, Oregon because it's a cool place. Well, I think Wichita, Kansas is a pretty cool place. I think South Central Kansas is a pretty cool place, but we have to have a reason. I want to have a reason that my kids stay here too. So with that, I will stand for questions.
Thank you, Jason. Your presentation is very informative, and it's something that we've all had various levels of conversation about one way or another within our own political groups that we have been elected to serve. So,
yes, sir.
I would have about 20 questions, but I think I'll reserve it for any comments or questions from the policy body.
I don't have current data, but I don't think many of the people in Sedgwick County, particularly in the smaller communities, understand how important the tax base of downtown Wichita is to the county,
right,
which affects us all. Do you have a number, what percentage in downtown, the tax base is in downtown Wichita?
We do. I can get that. I don't have it off the top of my head, but we do know that. It's significant. And really, for Wichita, I mean, it's much less than other metropolitan areas. I mean, other areas that have been at this much longer than us, the urban center subsidizes the rest of the city in a much greater capacity than we do. But yes, it's for what area geographically we represent, we're definitely greater tax revenue generator.
Jason, maybe you could get that information.
Yeah,
I'd love.
In fact, I know we got that. I just don't know the number off the top of my head. So we've asked that question. From a percentage standpoint, yeah.
Carl makes a good point. Well, also, I think the migration of to the Greater Wichita Partnership world has been very productive in a relatively short time, and then it allows you and downtown development to.
Right.
Focus on what you guys are doing. So
right.
It's good stuff. Seems to be so far.
And I know that group, you know, definitely will probably present to this group later in the year. But yeah, what it's allowed us to do, I mean, it's not that we didn't work together before, but now we're all under one roof. So you have the downtown EcoDevo group working with the regional context. And so when we do have businesses and groups looking at our region, we can look holistically and also add downtown to the conversation. Because not everybody, I mean, obviously, there's Newton might be the best solution. And so we're strategically working with all the partners to make sure that we get the right solution.
Good stuff. Any other questions or comments? Okay.
Okay.
Jason, thanks.
Thanks
for all you do. Okay, next up, move on to new business items. And the first one is an update on the sub-allocated funding balance plan. Kristen Zimmerman, senior planner, will give us an update.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon, everybody. We're glad to be here. I'm Kristen Zimmerman, again, senior planner, and I'm here today with my colleague Jason O'Brien. And we are here today to give you just a quick update on what's been the work that's been done to address a relatively small sort of administrative issue that's come up with WAMPO's project funding programs. So as you all know, our overall program is already in place. It's established, it's working. We do a new TIP every 2 years. We're awarding projects and funding projects in an ongoing way. We're not here today to talk about that. We're really just here to talk about this small issue that's come up. And in fact, we probably wouldn't really bring this sort of thing to you typically. It's very administrative in nature. We try to spare you these sorts of administrative things and try to handle them as your staff. That said, there is a new program being proposed, and so we wanted to loop you all in on that, and so you could get up to speed with what's been going on. So you might be asking yourself, well, what is this problem? What's the issue? Well, it has to do with our balance at the end of the year. So sometimes our balance is positive, sometimes it's negative. This really happens for a number of reasons. As many of you know that are dealing with projects, sometimes bids come in low, which is a good thing. So the cost comes in less than what we were budgeting it to be. Projects can drop out of the list, the scope changes, those sorts of changes. And you might also be asking, well, how much money are we talking about? What does this make up? Well, for the last 3 years or so, the amount has ranged from about $500,000 to $1 million. Although potentially it could be higher, it could be lower, it could be zero. It's really, frankly, just completely unpredictable. So because our program funding is ongoing, you know, ideally we'd prefer that we could just roll over any sort of positive balance to a future year and account for it then. Unfortunately, we just can't. The federal government has put in place regulations that we spend the amount we're allocated every year so that they can better manage the entirety of the federal program at the federal level. And keep in mind that, you know, any potential balance we do have has many constraints associated with it, even more than the eligibility requirements that are on these federal programs, funding programs to begin with. So we're really quite limited with what we can do with it and how it can be used. So because of that, we've taken sort of an accounting approach over the last 3 or 4 years to deal with this. What we've done is we've moved forward promised reimbursements. So for example, back in 2016, just last year, we had a positive balance, and we moved forward promised reimbursements that had been promised to project sponsors in 2017 and 2018. We moved those forward so they were available in 2016. It's sort of like paying off a loan early, just really making the money available sooner than it was originally scheduled. This process is established, it's worked, it works. Sometimes the issue is there's just not enough promised reimbursements to take up the entirety of the balance at the end of the year. And without a plan to take advantage of this, the money would be returned to the federal government and would be lost to the region. So we wanted to make sure we had a plan in place and that we could turn this issue really into an opportunity that would benefit our member communities, benefit the cities and counties sitting around this table, and something that would supplement our existing practice. So we've done that. So over the last couple months, WAMPO staff has been working with a subcommittee that was appointed by your Transportation Advisory Committee. We've been working with folks from cities that are staff that have been representing these cities that you guys are representing. And we've had four really good in-depth sessions. And it was really clear in the course of our work with this committee that a good way to solve this problem would be to do non-capital, non-construction projects, projects that are studies or plans, not actual construction or rehabilitation of roads or bridges or bike ped facilities, the sorts of projects we generally talk about here. So before I turn it over to Jason to fill you in on the details of what we've worked up, let me go over just a few of the constraints that our group kind of had to deal with in terms of how we could use this funding. There's four of them. So the first constraint has to do with the types of projects that we could use this balance on. And the answer is really not very many. Our hands are tied in lots of ways. We cannot use it for capital construction projects because the project development process for those types of projects takes approximately 33 months. And we're only going to have 6 to 8 weeks to use the money. The second constraint has to do with the certainty in terms of the dollar amount that would be available. And the answer there is it's very uncertain and very unpredictable. We really do not know what amount of funding we would have until way close to the end of the federal fiscal year. We could have a negative balance. It could be $0, it could be $100,000 or even more. And so because of this extreme uncertainty and unpredictability, we wouldn't want to put together a plan in place to pay for something that was desirable to us this year. You know, we'd want to plan for things that aren't necessarily necessary this year. And again, just as a reminder, over the last 3 years, our amount has ranged from about $500,000 to $1 million, which works out to be just about half to 1% of the entirety of our program. The third constraint has to do with the effect on our existing projects. We wanted to make sure that we were not taking anything away from those projects that are already programmed, those projects that are in our approved TIP that this group has approved, the projects that are already in the works. We wanted to make sure to keep those whole and nothing was being taken away. And then the fourth constraint has to do with the effect on WAMPO's existing planning and programming processes. So as you know, we carry out fairly extensive planning and programming processes. We do a new long-range plan every 5 years. We do a new short-range plan, the TIP, every 2 years. And this program really is not intended to replace those processes. It's really just intended to deal with this kind of administrative end-of-the-year balance issue. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Jason, and he's going to brief you on the work that the committee has done. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm going to talk about the new program that's part of this recommendation, the Planning Walkable Places program. I do want to start by thanking those of you in the room today who either served on the working group that went over this issue or were involved in some way. This was a hard project. We had less time to do our work than we do for our other planning processes, and this funding is a real tangle. So thanks for getting involved. One thing that we've emphasized from the beginning of this project was that the final recommendation provide a reasonable opportunity for participation by all of our member communities. That's been one of the cornerstones of the process. Member communities of all types and sizes were represented on the work group to ensure that all perspectives were considered. And this was not to change funding outcomes, but just to make sure that the opportunity was there in some kind of realistic way. On an administrative level, as Kristen said, what we really need for our issue is a pool of small non-construction projects. We need a single focus so that the administrative aspects don't get too crazy and then our solution just becomes another problem. We need projects that can be ready to go in just a few weeks. And they need to be non-critical projects for your communities because these funds are unstable. So they can go away. So that's where we started. Now, a few months later, we're happy to recommend a walkability-focused grant program for our member jurisdictions. These are pedestrian-related planning projects. These projects would be much smaller in cost, scope, and time to implement than our usual construction projects, just as this program is much smaller than our funding programs that are more well-known in our TIP. Given the typical costs of projects like these, the program would be about the right size and shape to provide a relief for our year-end balance issue. They'd provide that little extra buffer that we need to keep these funds in the region. It's a good supplement. The focus on walkability comes from issues we've heard about repeatedly for our member jurisdictions. They should be familiar to you. Lack of community identity, the need to develop tourism, lack of a sense of place, and the need to be a better venue for community events. There are a lot of other potential benefits, but those are some of the needs that we've heard about repeatedly throughout the process. the Mid-America Regional Council for some perspective. That's WAMPO's equivalent in the Kansas City region, has had a similar non-capital program going for a few years now, I think since 2014. We talked with them so that we'd have some idea what to expect if we wanted to go this route. And they told us that their program has been very popular with their member communities. It's been a big hit with everybody. Also, because of that existing program, there's already an established process with KDOT so that WAMPO and KDOT don't have to spend scarce resources reinventing the wheel. So there's a process and a pathway already in place. We've also talked with KDOT about their policies for a program like this, and we've gotten some helpful suggestions and also a green light to go ahead with the program if it's approved. For the focus, other non-construction ideas were considered. The first reason most of them were set aside was that the projects were not on an appropriate scale for the program. It's a tiny program. The walkable places focus would create this pool of small projects that could be responsive to a change in balance, this balance fund roller coaster that keeps going up and down. We could award more or fewer of these small projects, keeping them whole, rather than having a big project hanging out there that could then get in trouble if the funds drop sharply at the last second, which they could do. I'll also say that with a small fund and a tight schedule, a more diverse program, one where we could do all kinds of projects for a lot of different priorities, just is not something we could successfully do. A focus is needed, and that has to do with time frames for the most part. Some things we like about the proposed program, the small project size will allow us to do an open call. Everybody can participate, and we think we'll probably be able to award more widely than we can with our funding programs that have much more expensive projects. Other perks, the program, as Kristen said, would not remove any funds from existing TIP projects, and it will not require any additional revenues from the region. So at this point, we can talk more. But since the entire program will probably come in at a cost much less than even a single TIP project, I don't know how much time you'd prefer to spend on this. Can certainly answer any questions you have. I do have a presentation we can go through with a lot more details about the process and the recommendation itself. If you want to see that, that's all prepared. So I guess I'll ask how we're feeling at this point. Do we dive in some more?
This is a change in the past practice from, well, first of all, it's driven by the fact that the new rules say that if you have sub-allocated funds, it needs to be used up or returned.
Correct.
In the past, we moved those funds, well, not forward, but we could allow projects to accelerate.
That's correct. And also in the past, up till this year, KDOT has been a good state partner. They've helped us to roll a balance forward if we couldn't spend the money in time. They were never under an obligation to do that, but they did it for us, and we've been told that going forward they cannot do it anymore. So our goal is to get to a program of a size that we think represents what we might not be able to get spent.
But if there's still some projects that come in, or projects that are in the works, under construction, and we find that it's something's needed or adjusted, so part of that could go to the capital part of that construction still today, correct?
On a technical level, it could.
Right.
It's more difficult administratively because those projects this year have already been obligated, so there's already an agreement with the federal government. Another question was, we looked at that in our subcommittee, in our work group, and there was a strong focus on fairness was the term we used.
True.
And we looked at this question and saw that if this were to be the focus, that actually 19 of our 25 member jurisdictions would be automatically excluded from participating, which is, so we, it's something we could do, but that was the viewpoint that was taken.
So this would allow all of our member jurisdictions to, I'm trying to use our words, where they would be, they had a, they needed a study or a plan on something in their community that would cost, pick a number, 20,000, 30,000.
You know, tens of thousands.
Tens of thousands. And so, which they would not have been able to budget themselves, but allow to apply for, and this would be more quick turnaround in the smaller communities or the member communities.
I assume you're saying in comparison to a capital project.
Right.
Yes, the timing is very much an issue with this. We really are only going to have 6 to 8 weeks. So, you know, we've thought some about, you know, we'd want to put in a program that we would have some choices in place by the time we knew the balance and then could award within these 6 to 8 weeks.
Give us an example of types of programs that would be funded or types of studies that will be funded.
Yeah, sure thing. There's lots. It would be very flexible. We've put together a list of some, and we're also working on sort of a menu that we could pass out. But some of the things you could do is what's called kind of a safe routes to school plan. So, you know, maybe working with an individual school or with your district to help kids get to school safer and that are walking to school. Really anything that has to do with walking or pedestrian foot traffic. Another example that's came up a lot with our committee was the need to support community events. So things like, you know, if you have a 4th of July parade or a safe treat night in your community or some sort of summer festival, that there's some support for parking, you know, having a plan for parking, how to safely get people from where they park to where the event is, how to enhance the experience at the walking experience at the event. Those sorts of things.
I would add to that that came up in virtually every conversation that we've had, community events.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We've also had some folks bring up ideas of, you know, doing a plan for maybe a historic area of a community or a downtown to sort of revitalize that area, enhance its walking aspects, zoning overlays, all sorts of things that would just help communities better be able to support safe walking environments for everyone that lives there.
And I'll just add there's a lot of leeway for each individual community to decide on the character of the kind of project they want.
Okay, so this kind of is a fast clock, so you would know approximate the number and you would do a blast to all our member jurisdictions to say, please get us your list of projects to this. Is this the working group? Is it a TAC? Is it what's the committee that would be considered?
I'd like to make a comment. Part of this is that we've had a discussion about them keeping this team together or a variation of the team
okay.
to review proposals when they come in. So we will have an opportunity for a group of people that have been involved to actually look at proposals, make recommendations and stuff. So, and I'm a little early on that, but I wanted to throw it out there that it won't be you okay. two doing it. It'll be a group of people.
Dan, there's a list of the members that are in your, and maybe it's easier, Dan, you would just say who they are. There's only about 8 of them as of today that was the working group. So we can see the cross section. Dan.
We assume you that group would
say
who they are.
Or you say who they are. Yeah.
Get you. Bob Conger, City Manager Keachai, Paul from Community Planner, Jolene Graham from Mays, Paul Gunzelman, Wichita, Zach McHatton from Hayesville, Dan Squires, Derby, and Michelle Stroot, Wichita Transit.
That's not, we're not voting on that group to be the people, but I see what you're saying, Tom. Yeah, Claire.
Somebody may want off and somebody else can get on. We don't know. But
through Jolene, we've been keeping an eye on this in our little city, and we're looking forward to, we have several projects already that we think would fit into that. So we're looking forward to trying to utilize it in our town.
Feedback. Yes, sir, Carl.
Question. So basically, when this money comes about or this potential comes about, we need a plan that's ready to go and everything except funded.
Right. That was our intention.
Okay.
Well, the the full detailed scope wouldn't be necessary until procurement starts toward the end of the summer and into the fall. But
kind of helpful if we knew what we were doing, though, before we sent in an application.
The conceptual scope and at least enough to have a decent cost estimate is what we'd need sooner.
Yes, sir.
So you said that...
Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, Rich.
The current process, KDOT does what? Would you call it carry it forward?
That's correct. So in the past, the federal rules have been in place for a long time that you have to spend what you're allocated every year, you know, to help them better manage the program at the federal level. So that's been in place for a long time. In the past, KDOT has, I'm trying to think of a good way to say this.
They helped us carry it forward.
Yes, they helped us carry it forward.
And so why can't they do it any longer?
It's really some of their own constraints within their own organization. It's really kind of a cash flow constraint, because what they would do is they would take whatever balance we had of our federal money and spend it, and then they would replace it with their own. And so, in being a good partner and helping us to roll over, and it was very helpful to us. It was made it easier for us to manage our program, that we could account for it in the future and just roll it over. And what they're saying is, no, they cannot do that anymore, just from their own sort of budgetary constraints. And they didn't have to do it all along. You know, they did it to be a good partner and help us out.
Well, I think we need to follow up on that and see if there's a way to convince them to continue doing it. I like the idea of carrying it forward on projects that are in the TIP. I think that's a better use of the money. I'm concerned about we're just going to spend this money on things that, quite frankly, I think the entities themselves should be funding themselves, and then you're diverting money away from these important projects. That being said, if you do go forward, I'm also concerned that you're saying it's only for walkability thing. You may have municipalities that want to do a study for something else, and you know, I don't like it when the federal government says, here's some money, but you got to spend it on this, you can't do it on what you really need. And I'm concerned that we might be doing the same sort of thing here to our own selves. I mean, if we're going to let them do it for a grant or for whatever, let them pick whatever it is based upon their need. What happens when everybody has already done a walkability study? Then what are you going to, I mean, you know, so those are some of my concerns. But
this is not targeted just at walkability, is it? Or is it?
Walkability is the focus, but I did want to just clarify, I appreciate your concern, but the focus came from really conversations that we had within this region. And it's not, the focus isn't anything mandated by the federal government or the state.
No, I didn't say it was, but as years go by, someone may want to do a study that maybe isn't about walkability, and because it's not walkability, they're, you know, we'll rate them lower or something and say, no, we're going to give these other guys. So, I mean, I wouldn't constrain it here locally. Because needs change from year to year.
Yes,
and I know
yes.
There's a big push on walkability, and we want to make everyone think they got to do that, but...
I guess I would say two things. You know, I think you hit the nail on the head for why a big reason why this organization exists is to talk about these different priorities in the region and what is the best use of the money, you know, and so we have these existing processes to try to sort that out.
Okay. Rick, go ahead.
Yeah, just it might be helpful for the group for you all to walk through what are the types of eligible activities for the funding. I mean, you've talked about walkability.
Talk a little bit more about that now.
Mm-hmm. What other types of activities are eligible? I think that might be helpful.
Yeah, well, ideas we've heard from our members have been things like accessibility studies, walkability audits for their towns. And these aren't our ideas. These are things people, our communities, have told us they'd like to do. Downtown plans, Main Street plans. Some are considering zoning overlays, possibly. These are the ideas that are out there. We're planning on not trying to be very restrictive with this. I mean, we want to provide as much flexibility as possible. We just don't want it to get too big, because then there's a limited time frame and it's a small program. So we wouldn't want there to have to be so much administration that then the administration is really bigger than the program itself. So that's the line we're trying to walk. But we do want to provide as much flexibility as we can. Like we said, our interest is that our member communities have as much discretion as possible to decide on the character of the projects that they do.
Does the grant have to cover the whole cost, or can it be a portion of, like, let's say the city wants $10,000 for their study that's going to cost $50,000?
It would be an 80-20 match. You know, we would require a 20% of the cost that the community would pay, and then the grant would cover 80%. And I would also say, you know, we're I think a lot of the talk in our committee was this sort of no harm, no foul approach, that if there is no demand for this, you know, we'll just go and do what we have been doing with moving forward these promised reimbursements, and that it's not taking away money from projects. And if there is no demand, then we'll just move on and do what we've always been doing.
Moving forward promised reimbursements is different than what KDOT's been doing?
Yes, those are two separate processes. Okay. Yes.
I got you, because you're going on. Okay, yeah. Well, I think that's a preferred method to these grants. I'm sorry, but I think these things that you're talking about, there may be a need out there, but I think they're things that should be funded by the individual entities themselves. I mean, they have local property taxes. That's what it should be good for. I'd rather put these things back on the tip or things like that than.
Tom?
I'm not going to add anything right now, other than that there's specific ways you can spend the money, and you can't necessarily spend it on a road. So, and that's what they're trying to do, is reallocate that money.
Bob.
Mr. Chairman, to address some of those concerns too, I sat on the subcommittee, and one of the things we talked about also was connecting links. And some of those may be where two cities might partner, say between Colwich and Bentley, or Colwich and Mays, that might actually go together and decide to create some sort of a walkable or bike path that might help connect those cities, or connect activity centers within cities. So it's not restricted just to individual locales. It certainly gives an opportunity on a regional basis for partnerships to occur and to enhance that.
And this doesn't eliminate, still, if a project was in process and the scope changed from what it still would have some eligibility for capital contribution to that project. But that's where you have to do a lot of legwork to get it in there.
Yeah. You mean contributions to existing capital projects?
Yeah, yes.
You know, technically it's possible, even though there's a few more hoops, because there's already, you know, the projects are already obligated. And that's just where we ran into our issue of most of our member communities couldn't participate then with that.
Right.
And I think we would want to follow up in a practical way with KDOT. You know, when these projects get put into the system, they're coded a certain way. And once they're sort of set in place, it's hard. We would want to follow up and make sure we could actually make that happen. I don't know for sure right now.
Okay. Could. Claire?
I think it's a wonderful opportunity for small towns to have money to use to plan for things that we've been wanting to do for some time and couldn't handle all the money. I really don't think you'll have any problem using it up.
Janet?
Add a couple of things to that. One is, as a reminder, we are the Wichita Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, which does imply that we have a responsibility to community planning in a regional connected way. And so I think we can certainly make, as this task group has, a good case for using the funding on planning for transportation, which includes a lot more than just cars these days. There are other forms of transportation. So I think that makes a lot of good sense. We have been on occasion using some of these funds, although not all of them, which is part of the problem. Some of these funds to supplement TIP projects. If, for example, a TIP project runs into a situation where something unexpected comes up, or somebody points out that if you connected this to that, that would make a lot of sense, make this a better project, and it wouldn't add that much to the cost. And that, I think, has resulted in some better projects on occasion. And so I'm wondering if the committee gave any thought to, you know, setting aside some percentage of these unallocated funds to possibly do that if those needs arise. Maybe it's, I don't know, 25 or 30% of the funds to be available for that, if that kind of thing should arise, and having the balance be available for the planning studies. And then if there were no TIP projects that needed supplementary funds to allocate the whole amount to the planning studies.
Definitely talked about that. We went through several options with this group. We wanted to be thorough and comprehensive, and this one did come up. I mean, it's essentially awarding more money up to the maximum, the 80%, to an existing project. And you know, as the committee discussed, that really did not get a lot of traction for several reasons. One was that really it would limit participation to, I guess, what did we, 19, like, well, si- let's see, only, only five, be... five jurisdictions that could take advantage of this, which would sort of mean, you know, 3/4 of our cities would be eliminated from participating in this. That was kind of a big strike against it. And then there was also a lot of discussion about how this would sort of undercut the existing decision-making process and the original decisions that were made when the projects were awarded. There was some feeling that there was not interest there. And then the third reason really was more of this practical one, where once these projects start and get obligated and get set up in the system, they're set up for a federal maximum, and the logistics of getting that changed would be very tricky. So those are sort of the reasons that it was the discussion, I guess, that the group had when they were evaluating this option.
Well, another issue with that would be what's 25 or 35% of an unknown amount is another problem, and that we won't even know how much there is in the balance until mid-July, mm-hmm. at which point we'll have 6 to 8 weeks to get everything obligated.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay, we can have some more discussion, but this is an item that is an action item for vote, and we could, I was talking to Phil and the executive committee in our meetings, it doesn't have to be voted today, so we can digest this and get more information and vote on it the next meeting, or if it's the desire of the body to put it to a vote right now under as proposed and as discussed, then we can do that too.
Personal. I think it's set to go back to the TAC, isn't it, for their recommendation. And I think before we jump into doing that, we really ought to have a recommendation going back from the TAC at that point to see if they want to expand this just from walkability to maybe other transportation sources. There may be a study on rail. There may be a study on bus transportation, those type of things. So I think we'd be a little preliminary if we were to jump in and vote today.
Good point. Okay, any other discussion?
Send it to TAC.
Okay, we don't need one? Okay, we can just take no action on that, and it will remain, it will go to the TAC for their input, and then we'll bring it back next month.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, very informative. Okay, next up, we will have to take an action on, and that is the WAMPO Employee Handbook, and Mr. Austin Parker. I recall that over the last year, we have moved from including payroll and employee handbook from under the City of Wichita payroll, all that, to now we're independent. And so with that, as most of you are in a business, then you get to do the wonderful things like an employee handbook. And Austin, it's included in here, but you're going to hit the highlights for us, probably.
Yes, I'll hit the highlights and keep it as brief as possible.
That's okay. All right. Say what you need to say.
I will. So I'll give you a little bit of background on how we got to here. Staff worked in reviewing private and public employee handbooks from throughout the United States, and I think from several of our other neighbor MPOs throughout the region and the country, to develop a template that I was able to review, and I inserted some provisions designed primarily after other area governmental personnel policies for compliance with state and federal law. And it resulted in the handbook before you. Worked, and primarily the work was between Vicky and Phil worked towards putting together the template. I worked then with Vicky and Phil through a legal review process, coming up with the final document. You'll notice if you choose to click on the icon to take you down to the actual document, starting on page 444, you'll find a detailed table of contents that's about 4 pages long. It's broken up into sections, topical sections. First one's very typical. You find a values mission statement of the organization. Then there's an employee handbook acknowledgement and receipt that the employees will sign that they have read and received a copy of the document for review. The next section deals with employee benefits, heavily staff driven, and also some for compliance with federal law. Then there's a section on diversity that details WAMPO's anti-harassment policy. And technology has failed me. Give me 1 second here. Okay. Diversity section, there's also workplace bullying and some language for the Americans with Disabilities Act. Employment, some conditions of employment, such as employee classification categories, background and reference checks, some other provisions, introductory period, performance appraisals, progressive discipline, discussion about separation from employment, procedures for disciplinary action, grievances, those things such as that. Again, excuse me. Ah, okay. And then some workplace expectations, confidentiality, how we deal with personnel files, meals and rest breaks, mandatory meal periods. Just scan down through conflicts of interests, unique one for governments and employee oath, as we are a public entity. Citizenship verification, compensation, types of compensation, payment, employee travel and reimbursement policies, social media and electronic communication and usage, something that's evolved over the past several years. We have one of those policies, as do most of your member jurisdictions, I'm confident. Policy on solicitations, distributions, and posting of materials in the workplace. So that's a very, very brief overview. I'd stand for any questions. Do the best that I can to field them.
That's a very serious document for sure. So I don't mean to be any way discount that. So.
Oh no, no, it's, but it's true. I mean, it's something that whether you're a public or a private employer these days, that most everybody's got one, and you have to go through it. So.
And you got this from, you reviewed the previous handbook from the city and then whatever your experience is with other employee handbooks. And I believe Phil has had a lot of input on it with his familiarity with it. It did go back once or twice for some further review. So it's kind of been washed through from our director's perspective as well. So I have a level of confidence that it's a working document that's pretty good. Any questions?
I have one. Okay. Phil or Vicky, either one, don't have anything they'd like to add today, or just
if I never have to look at the,
as is presented?
If I never have to look at the document again, it would be fine. So.
Second that.
It's been a motion and a number of seconds, so this is an eager one to get approved. You could put Claire down as, oh, Jim, you have something to say.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to, I've been trying to read through this a little bit, and I guess I do have a couple of questions. And is this just an update of an existing handbook, or is this a new document?
It's a relatively new document.
Okay. Yes.
What about the benefits that are outlined in this? Are those benefits already basically in place, or is there anything new offered in this document that establishes new benefits?
I don't believe we're establishing anything that's new. I think there's some that may have slight, and I would defer to WAMPO staff on this, but I think that they may be slightly different. They may not be quite what the city of Wichita offered its employees, but obviously we're a smaller organization, so we work within those constraints. But I believe they're typical of what was offered to employees at Wichita. I believe that's correct.
I guess just my perspective is I'm looking at this for the first time today, and I'm not that familiar with Wichita's employee handbook or policies, and so some of this is new to me. For example, I guess I'm a little maybe I'm alone on this, but I was a little bit surprised to find that there was a pension plan offered for part-time employees as well as vacation for part-time employees, and a few other things like that. And I guess I just would like a chance to read through this once. Sounds like we're getting ready to adopt this, but this is a pretty lengthy document, and I guess I'm not ready to vote on it yet.
Yeah, well, that's good input.
Just a point of clarification. Are these are not, I'm under the impression that when we approved the benefits, one of two things, either existing employee benefits have transferred over when they became WAMPO employees, solely of WAMPO, or we approved when we went through that process of the benefits package that those had been approved. That somehow these things are already in place. We're not deciding on a new set of benefits today that we can change.
Yes.
And
no, you are correct. These are all the benefits that are reflected, particularly the ones that are relating to the compensation for the employees, like the 457 plan. Those were all put into place several months ago through our engagement of AG&H and a Hinkle Law Firm to assist with implementation of employee benefits. So
we also tried to ensure that all the benefit packages correlate with our budget, so there's no additional impact on the budget.
Okay. Well, there's been a motion and a second on adopting this one, and we've heard comments from Commissioner Howell. But any other comments before we probably need to address the motion and the that's on the floor?
Just a point of clarification. I may be mixing this up with a draft that I saw, but this is not the first time this has come to this board. Did we get the full document at the prior meeting, or did we? I mean, I've seen it before, but I don't remember if it was presented to us as.
I'm not sure that it's been ever formally presented to the entire TPB, but I understand there's been communications through WAMPO staff, and I think various members of the TPB and maybe the executive committee concerning draft forms of the document. Phil, am I kind of accurately summarizing where various drafts of the document have gone?
I think we were going to look at it last meeting, and a preliminary review said it needed some more work. There was some, okay. There was some duplication and some things like that it was more cleaning up some dot and T's and I's more so than any change of any benefits or anything like that.
No, that's right.
Yes. Dennis.
To clarify, I did receive an email on April 4th that had the agenda with all of the details, and this was included in that email back on April 4th, so I have had a chance to review it.
Okay. So there's been a motion and a second. Any other conversation? If not, if everybody... All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, the motion carries. Thank you, Austin, for your work.
Thank you, and thank you, staff.
Okay, next action item is transit representation on the policy body. We've had a handful of discussions about this. We're trying to we're under an effort to where there's a, you know, we're one of the, again, we're one of the few MPO areas that the city provides the transit system. Many other cities and MPOs have a regional transit authority. And so we are one of the few that has the Wichita Transit Authority. But it also involves federal, much federal involvement in the in the public bus and paratransit world. So with that, we've discussed that the to meet some federal requirements to have a position on of a transit representation on the there's a couple of ways we can do it. I'm kind of jumping here to a conclusion. We checked into a representative of Wichita Transit serves on the policy body. Now our policy body though is elected officials only. That could be problematic. It would add as a voting member, that would give one more vote to a entity that is Wichita. But we did find that we could also put a member of the transit group on our policy body as a non-voting member. And with that, that would satisfy some federal requirements. And Rick, if you want to jump in when I finish here, federal requirements. And one of the things that's really important is that we're finding out that the newly assigned FAST Act really leans on a member of a policy of the transit being involved. Rick, can you add a little bit? Because Paul was helpful on this as well.
Okay. Yeah, no problem, man. Sorry for being late. I was racing from K-State, actually. Yes, it is a requirement. But to be honest, I need a little more time to determine whether or not it can be non-voting. I think my assumption was it had to be a voting member, but I've not been part of the loop on the conversation, so.
Okay. I think it was part of the certification review. Maybe we can get some feedback here from Phil.
The certification review had stated that they would like to see a representative from a transit on the policy body. At one time, both Paul and Daniel, the federal representatives at the TAC, had stated that it doesn't necessarily have to be a voting member. But the FAST Act, I think, specifies that it has to be a voting member.
That was my understanding in addition.
There was kind of a difference in opinion with Paul and Daniel saying at some point in time the rule did not make it real specific, since Wichita Transit is a department of the city of Wichita, whether it would have to be a voting member on this body.
Since they are, and I still am fuzzy on, I mean, I don't mind him being on as a non-voting member, because I think if we put him on as a voting member, then we got to, like, say, something's going to have to give somewhere else because of the weighing situation. I guess having him as a non-voting member and you having several city council members from City of Wichita on this board, I think that they do have a vote per se on that. But, you know, anybody from the transit, you know, they have great information. I have no problem. When you get into the whole other part of it, you know, does that outweigh, because, I mean, the number of commissioners from the county and the area cities and whatnot, other members, that does skew the voting. So I kind of, it's double-edged sword. I mean, if they want him on here, fine, but I don't see where voting, as you already have multiple folks from the city of Wichita voting, can be representative I guess I'm a little fuzzy on why that's not okay.
Rick and then Janet.
Well, I guess a clarification is if you were all, it's ultimately your decision, if you were to set the parameter, it is Wichita City Transit, but they're providing transit for a good majority of the region. Is that correct?
Oh, Steve, can you answer that, please? I don't think we...
Because where I was going to go with this is if...
Okay, go ahead.
Provide just some brief clarification. Our federal funding allocation covers the metropolitan area, which is beyond the city limits. Our fixed route service operates within the city limits. Our paratransit service has operated within the city limits, but does step outside a bit. We also are designated recipients of the 5310 funds, which again step outside as we allocate, work with WAMPO to allocate those funds and oversee those projects. They also step outside of the city limits. So there is precedent for, and some of the services we provide do step outside, although the majority are fixed routes in.
Was that where I was going with this is I don't, somehow setting, maybe one option might be setting parameters that their vote has to be based on the regional, the transit needs of the region, not necessarily that they're representing the city of Wichita. I don't know how you would do that, but I mean, but that's the purpose of why they would be a voting member per the FAST Act.
They really don't, I don't really think we consider them a regional entity. They are a city of Wichita. I think you make the argument they're already represented by the city of Wichita representative. Is it specific? I guess I'll have to look up the actual rule or regulation. Specifically say the transit authority, or I mean, what's the exact requirement?
The language talks about transit operator. So Wichita is the transit operator, the provider of transit. Normally, in most parts of the country, a transit operator can be either a quasi-governmental agency, it can be a private company. In this case, in this region, it's the city. Apparently, the city of Wichita is hosting it. Now, your paratransit is beyond just within the city limits of Wichita.
Right, but it's the operator is the city of Wichita.
Janet, you wanted to comment?
Just to fill in here, I'm the one who brought this up again, and I brought it up because if you remember, one thing I do remember from last meeting for sure is when we got the update on the certification review, this issue came up, and I asked specifically at that time if the person needed to be a voting member. And what I don't remember is if it was which of the two gentlemen said no, it didn't have to be a voting member. So once I heard that and got confirmation of that, then I said to members of the executive committee, well, if it does not have to be a voting member, then why would we not go ahead and do it in order to get one more thing crossed off on our certification review checklist. So we may have gotten bad information from in terms of this, it has to be a voting member or not. I would defer to you. You probably know, not probably, I'm sure you know. So probably what we need to do is just be able to cite where in the FAST Act that shows up as a, you know, that we need to do that. Because I do understand the concern. Wichita technically is the operator of transit, so I suppose you could say that transit is the operator is on the board already. I cannot say that the four city council members that are on this board are as well versed on transit issues as is the department director that is the transit operator. So I think the board could benefit from having that perspective on it, the transit. But I understand the concern about having it be a voting member, because technically transit's already voting in a sense. So I'm, since I'm the one who brought it up, I thought I would just explain why I brought it up. Was because I thought, not I thought, we were told one thing and now we're hearing something else. So probably we just need to get this little thing cleared up and then we'll know what we need to do. We either have transit on and or we don't.
Not to start a back and forth, but what did the meeting minutes say? Who was the person that brought up?
That was at our last meeting.
Yeah.
I don't have those in front of it. I don't remember if it was Daniel because or
my
Paul.
My question regards if, for example, it was FTA, perhaps they had talked to the regional council, and the regulation may say one thing, but the regional council interpreted
it.
Is
it something else?
So, I think, in all fairness, you know, that's part of it. I mean, the other part I would also add, though, is we have other parts of the country where. You have, like, for example, in New York, you have the Metropolitan Transportation Authority, which is a state agency, but they are the provider of transit and railroads. They have a separate vote than New York State DOT. They all report to the governor, but, you know, so, but they regionally provide transit, so.
You know, I guess we need to look, if we're going to add them, and I'm fine with that, then we need to relook at our voting weight to make sure where we're at. I mean, because we do have things in place. And what you're saying makes sense. I mean, at least I feel that's the first time it's been explained to me like that. But still, there's other issues we need to look at, just from Adam, another member. If he's a non-voting member and he provides great information at every meeting, that's fine. But if he needs to be a voting member, then we need to look at the bylaws and see what we need to do to make that happen.
Comment I got to make on this is we're right where we were last year. We don't have a definitive answer for Federal Highways, so until we get that in writing, I'm not going to vote one way or the other. So, and I think we need it in writing. We need to ask for it in writing, and we need to ask for an answer in writing. Because we brought that, I think last March it came in here, and we were talking the same thing, and we still got the same football in there. So.
And Rick, I'm looking at the minutes. I don't see.
Yeah, I'm looking at them too, and I'm not seeing it in here.
I don't
so
see
maybe
it defined
somebody,
in there.
We just need to.
But again, you know, getting a readout on the results of an audit and how we were doing verbally is different than getting in something in writing and saying what we have to pursue. So.
Sure. And my slight expansion on what Janet said about a city council member representing transit. I mean. If I was the designated transit person, I'd have to have Steve sitting here right here telling me the acronym, telling me the ratio, telling me the funding. I mean, it'd just be a puppet world because I don't think anybody, when you don't work it and live it, you just don't know it. So it'd be very awkward and difficult for one of the city appointees to serve as the transit designee in a more detailed explanatory way. So.
Don't they show up whenever they're needed on as needed basis and give us that information anyway without particular being a voting member? I mean, and this is a policy body. I mean, we don't have our director of public works on. You know, I could say the same thing about my public works director. I don't know all the details he does, but we're a policy body. And when we need to know information from transportation, they're always here. They'll give us that update and they can be involved. But I share concerns about them being on the.
Right.
Think it's Rick. Not broke, don't fix it.
I'd like to say on the side, though, too, we've also had a discussion about having a representative from transportation or transit that could be Steve, but not represent the city of Wichita and represent transit in general. I don't know how we would do that, but we have kicked that can down the road, too, because there's more here than just buses. I mean, you know, so.
Well, if I can speak, I mean, FTA is not here, and I know the comment was made Federal Highways, but it's actually, you know, they're the prime proponent of transit operators. So one option would be, if you need clarification on the question, send us an email or a letter, and we'll formally respond with, but it needs to go to us and to FTA.
Okay. Well, I think
I think that's a good idea. Let's do that. Staff did point out where we covered that topic in the minutes. That's in here, but it doesn't have questions and answers in the minutes. And so it would be good to have it in writing. I think that's a great idea. So we do that.
Austin, you got something to add? Council?
Motion to defer that.
The benefit of quick legal research on multiple phones in the back of the room. So take it as it may. But it appears there may be some language in U.S. Code Section 134, Subsection C, Subsection 2, and 1 that may lead us to our answer, but it talks about officials, okay?
And what?
It talks about elected. It talks about, let me, I'll try to get to it directly here. Hold on.
I don't really see that we need to define this today. I would like to move along with the meeting and just get a written.
I would make a motion that we defer this until we get an answer from.
I appreciate your
highways.
Effort, but.
Okay, so. I'd appreciate that. We have some language, but
I
think it
that
would
motion.
Be.
You're yes. saying request, Tom, that they put it in writing to us?
Right.
Yes.
That we put it in writing and ask for it back.
We
get
an answer back to us citing which sections that we need to be doing so we right. truly have it written to us. I
yes.
think even our last meeting, Paul said he would be able to do those type of things in our mm-hmm. certification. So I think we need it cited to us for sure.
We're going to add a seat. We need to add it the right way. So,
okay. So that would be appropriate.
Motion. So,
I'll second that.
Yeah.
Okay. Been a motion and second. Any other comments? Being none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Okay. The motion carries. Hey, Rick, thanks for your input too on this as well. So, we have one more quick item, and then respectful of Commissioner Dennis's time frame, then I'll go to another thing in the next thing. But in your packet, you have the executive committee did a roles and responsibilities. This again is some cleanup from the employee handbook, but it further defines the roles and responsibilities. The main part of that is that there was a spending, there's background and then considerations. Mainly what we wanted to do was fiscal budget considerations. You see in your packet, there's we talked about limitation on who could spend what and how much. We've all been through that exercise. And the executive committee took a position of lower limits than expanding higher spending limits. And the limits were like 0 to 5,000 for human resources and a finance manager, $0 to $20,000 limit, an executive director, and then anything over $20,000 would come to the full policy body. Phil has said that he could count on two fingers the time he's had to make a decision over $20,000. So it was a little higher when we first talked, but I think over our executive panel, we thought that we'd stay with these lower limits. There's a few other descriptions of the roles and responsibilities. So if you want to hit any highlight, Phil.
Actually, they're just mostly administrative details that are not included in the handbook, but we want you to be aware of them. The majority of the guidance we're seeking is just on the expenditure limits. Just make sure that you're comfortable with those expenditure limits.
If there's any questions about that, if not, we can take a motion to accept these roles and responsibilities as outlined. We can amend it, or we could disapprove it.
I make motion we approve the role and responsibilities as presented.
Okay, thank you. Any other discussion? Okay, there's been a motion on the floor to approve, and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Being none, the motion passes. Thank you. Next is the executive committee. I've made reference to it. We've We've met last month and covered a lot of really what has been on today's agenda. And I think we've mentioned whenever the executive committee had come together on some of this previous stuff. The one thing that we did not mention, well, there's two things. The first thing is that we felt that the executive committee and the chair, as myself, felt that Sedgwick County should have a representation on the Sedgwick County or on the executive committee. So we would like to recommend that we appoint David Dennis as a recommended with his experience on some of the other planning and other MAPC. We thought he'd bring value to the executive committee, and Sedgwick County had not been represented in a little while. So I understand that we're supposed to bring that to the policy body and as a motion and a second and approve that he's added to that David's added to the executive committee.
Yes. I'm sorry. I didn't
tell me. Tell me where I'm Aaron.
Oh, Aaron. You're not Aaron at all.
Okay.
he's quoted you the procedure underneath our bylaws that as chairman of the executive committee, the motion or the appointment has been made to the TPB for Commissioner Dennis, and that requires a motion and a second and then a vote on that appointment by the TPB.
Motion, we approve the chairman's appointment to the executive committee.
Okay, been motioned and seconded. Stephanie? Yeah. Sorry. Any other discussion? Okay, there's been a motion and a second on the floor. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Okay, David, thank you for joining us. The only other thing I have for the executive committee is that we will have a very brief executive session at the end of today's meeting on a rather an important matter, but it should be a 10-minute executive session at the end. So that concludes my report. So moving on, Tom Jones.
The only thing I've got to report at the TAC is that there was a review earlier today about the residual funding being left over, and at the request of staff, we're looking at extending that team to look at those proposals when they come in. Like I said, it will be either the existing team or some form of that team. Maybe somebody drop off, somebody gets added on. The other thing that came out of the TAC meeting is a freight team was put together, and Dan will be chairman of that.
We met last week.
I thought you met, but I wasn't positive. I don't know if you want to discuss that.
Ready for a report, Gloria?
I just wanted to let people know that it was happening. So,
the Corbin Freight Working Group met last week. They have reached a series of recommendations on potential projects and corridors. They are in the process of providing me with their prioritization of the projects so that we know which ones are 1, 2, 3, and 4. They have till tomorrow to get that to us. It'll go to the TAC at their meeting on the 24th, and it'll come as a recommendation to this body at their meeting next month.
Thank you, Glory.
I don't have anything else.
Okay. Thank you, Tom. Any questions for Tom in the TAC world? Okay, moving on, other partnership reports. Mike Moriarty's not here. I don't think KDOT is represented, or yes, I'm sorry. Please, welcome.
Thank you. I'm filling in for Tom today. He's off at an engineering conference. Some of the highlights from last week include the National Work Zone Awareness News Conference that took place in Topeka on April 6th. State Transportation Engineer Catherine Patrick and KDOT staff shared their work zone experiences, and numerous other partners also participated as well. This event was just one of several activities in Kansas. Buildings and structures across Kansas lit up orange last week to highlight work zone safety. Various safety messages were shared throughout the week to encourage drivers to pay attention to the task at hand, driving. Electronic message boards along highways had also had rotating work zone safety messages. And speaking of work zones, I was given an update on the red project from Tom. For this week's highlights, US 54 from Hoover to West Street under I-235 is reduced to two lanes in each direction until October. On Saturday, April 22nd, 7 a.m. until 7 p.m., West Street will be closed under US 54 for bridge work over West Street traffic lanes. That's a new update. The eastbound US 54 east, the eastbound US 54 exit ramp to West Street will be closed from mid-April until late 2017 to complete the new ramp from northbound I-235 to eastbound US 54 and to West Street. That's coming soon. The only other event coming up Tuesday today will be an ozone day for Wichita. We will be posting messages on various Which Way dynamic message signs, but not all of them. A set of standard approved messages have been approved and will be, you know, correlating throughout the day.
Okay, thank you. So when the citizens call their city council member or the county commission about what are you doing on West Kellogg, can we defer them to you?
Until Tom comes back, yes.
Okay, Tom, we'll give it to Tom. Okay. All right. Okay, thank you. And then, Rick, you're next on the list. Thank you for being here.
Oh, sure. Great. It's been a busy few weeks. I will try to make the meetings every month, but given schedule, sometimes I'm just not available. So
understand.
Participate. And I actually just came here from the engineering conference that Zach was talking about, and I was actually one of the speakers at the Work Zone press event last Tuesday. So it's been a busy few weeks. I wanted to give an update, kind of a number of updates to provide. First off, on transition. You know, our discussions are continuing with our new Secretary Chow. We've been briefing her on our programs. And I'm sure folks have been watching the news, but a lot's been happening. We do have a deputy secretary that's going through final Senate confirmation, Jeff Rosen, who also has quite a lot of DOT experience and will be coming on board. Funding. I know we had the discussion with the sub-allocation. Just so that folks are aware, in terms of the overall federal funding program, we continue to be under a continuing resolution that started on December 9th, which is going to expire on April 28th. We're waiting to see what our extension will be. And to give an example of kind of what the impact of this is, we provide federal highways. For this fiscal year, we're providing $383 million to the state of Kansas. This would make our third continuing resolution. We've been operating on providing our partner KDOT $199 million, which began on December 9th, which will go through April 28th. Of that, $383 million. Congress funded us at FY federal funding year 16 levels versus 17. So there's actually another $6 or $7 million that we could be passed through to get pass on to you all and your entities. So a lot's going to be happening. Congress is on recess for 2 weeks. When they get back, you know, stay tuned. We'll see what happens, how much money we're providing at that point. So, but lots will be happening. Our obvious desire would be that we would receive a FY17 funding to take us through the end of the year. But lots to happen and more to come on that. Wanted to mention that Paul Foundoukas is been selected within our agency for a rotational assignment. He's going to be working on national highway statistics issues, the HPMS program policy. I had sent an email out. Hopefully some of you all have received it. I think I'd sent it to Phil. But he'll be starting this assignment on April 17th through July 28th. His supervisor, John Knowles, our team leader for program development, will be your POC contact in the interim. Now, the letter that you're going to be sending, we'll be working with Paul and John to get a response on that, but that'll be happening. Wanted to make folks aware that there was also an email that was sent out today. Mark has led an initiative, a discussion with Federal Highways about I don't know if folks are aware, I know that Gloria certainly is, about mega regions. There's been a number of forums that have happened around the country. For example, Memphis held a mega region forum, very much focused in on freight and Mississippi River traffic, Missouri River traffic. Mark has proposed the idea of a mega regions forum for the Mink states, which would be Missouri, Kansas, Iowa, and Nebraska. And that has garnered feet. It is moving forward. There was a one pager that was just sent out, and I believe Phil should have received it. That, and I think Lori as well, that gives some concept to this, but they are tentatively looking at having this two-day forum. The focus is state DOTs, MPOs, also major freight operators such as the Class 1 railroads, UP, BNSF. The current date that's being proposed is at the end of June. If not then, it'd probably be August, September timeframe, but just want to give a heads up that that's out there. We've already been asked, will there be federal funds provided for accommodation? And no, this is really kind of on your dime to come and participate. But I would definitely encourage you all to take a look at that one pager and see if that's something, you know, the intent of it is to get a dialogue for what are the unique needs of these four states. While Kansas City, Mark, is the spoke of the wheel, it's certainly, you know, Wichita is as much of a player as Mark is. So just want to put a heads up for that. A couple months ago, we had received a request via Phil about, I know that you as a policy board have been looking at best practices of, I know Janet Miller had also talked to us about this. So are there some examples of similar type metro areas around the country and similar to Wichita that are, you know, looking to make their policy board stronger? What works best for them? What are some good best practices? So I believe at the meeting, the previous meeting that I was at, I talked about we were working on that. We are developing a PowerPoint presentation. We have been working with our resource center, and I'd like to offer at the May meeting to make that presentation on what we've been able to find. That PowerPoint would then be followed up with some white papers of what are some good best practices that we were able to find out, and it could be an opportunity for you all to then to reach out to those MPOs. I know that Phil and I talked about Tulsa possibly being one of them. I've not been in the direct loop of what they've been percolating in their coffee makers, so I'm looking forward to seeing what their PowerPoint provides to me as much as you all. So, but I would like to offer that I could certainly present at the next policy board meeting what those findings were, and then we could also take that input and use that towards the white paper. So we're producing. So, a couple of other things. There was an invitation letter that came from WAMPO to Gloria Shepherd, our acting executive director, to speak at the next CAMPO meeting. Unfortunately, she will not be able to attend, but I will be providing remarks on behalf of Gloria, so just wanted to make folks aware that we're preparing for that. We're working, and that should be a broader big picture than just what's going on in Kansas, obviously. What's going on in the planning realm? So just wanted to mention that, and that's what I have. Any questions for me?
Volume of information, Rick. Thank you. Any other questions for Rick? Thanks again for being part of the day. Lastly is Wichita Transit. Mr. Spade.
There's a reason I kept it brief today. So I just had a couple update on a few things for you. First of all, I reported last month that we were having a workshop on future mobility management, and that's now scheduled for Thursday, April 27th. And a number of you are invited to participate in this, particularly some of the communities that are linked directly to Wichita, as we do have a responsibility to reach out in a regional manner. Also, we have an open house on the 26th that we'll be getting invitations out to too. Queue line improvements are scheduled to kick off on Saturday, May 13th. That's a week later than I originally told you. Just want to make sure y'all know, and you'll be getting information on that rollout. And then again, I think Phil reported that the 5310 program, which is something being offered cooperatively between ourselves and the MPO. Request for applications is out, and application deadline is on May 19th. We also provided you with just a document that talks about a little bit about our transit service workshop called Mobility Management Beyond the Big Bus. And this is casual reading for you all, but it starts to give you a sense of what we're trying to do in terms of our transportation planning and coordination, and to give you a sense of maybe some of the things we'll be talking about at the workshop. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Steve. Any questions for Steve before he exits the... Okay, thank you. We may have lost our quorum. We're going to find out in just a second. And if we've lost our quorum, then we will take the executive session up next meeting. Kathy, do you know, do we have enough people? What's our count? Okay. If Troy was caught, then we'll have our quorum. If not, we will be adjourned.
Session, I could leave.
Yeah. Yeah, just so we need we need one more voter.
I'm staying so clear of that comment.
All right, let's give it just a second and look positive. Austin ran out. Anybody else got something exciting to share? Claire, what are all these projects you're working on in Mays we need to know about?
We have a new business going into our industrial park.
That's good.
Japanese business that is for lubricants.
That been announced? I mean, it is now, I guess, huh?
A formal announcement will be about 2 weeks, I think.
Oh, we have a quorum. Okay, in the essence of Troy's time, Troy, do you got this 10 minutes at the most? Okay, thank you. We don't want to read about
She's
you
nine,
in the paper.
That's fine.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, well, let me make the motion first, and then we'll shut the tape down. All right, I'm going to make a motion to go into executive session under the personal matters of non-elected personnel, in the exception of the Kansas Open Records meeting, and to discuss matters related to non-elected personnel, and to invite our WAMPO attorney, Austin Parker, to be a part of this for the next 10 minutes. Executive session will begin as soon as everybody's vacated, so it'll begin at 4:55, and we will reconvene at
5:05.
That's the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
A motion and second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? Being none, we will start executive session.